Join Edwin Frondozo on the Business Leadership Podcast every week for a unique program featuring insights and actionable items from the world's most successful business leaders. Hear firsthand the exclusive interviews and personal journeys on how today's transformational leaders made it to the top.
When you're burning out, you are overwhelmed. There's too much going on. There's too many things jam-packed in your calendar, too many things that are demanding your attention. So get back to what's essential and start pushing away guilt-free the things that are not essential.
This is the Business Leadership Podcast, and I'm Edwin Frondozo. Welcome. How are you doing today? Thank you for joining me. This is episode number 68, and my guest today is Hamza Khan. He is the Managing Director of Student Life Network. And in our conversation, we discuss what the four ingredients of purpose are, what ARC, or what he termed ARC, is, and how he applies it to his team, members, and clients, how you overcome burnout, and maybe more importantly, how you identify the 12 stages of burnout. We talk about ways to better your resistance to stress, and lastly, the skill that you need to beat AI. This episode is brought to you by Dell, empowering Canadian entrepreneurs with the tools, technology, and resources they need to succeed. Also, the Business Leadership Podcast is a friend of the ITWC Podcast Network and supported by our media partner, IT World Canada. Now, here we go.
Welcome to the Business Leadership Podcast, Hamza.
Hey, man. Thank you for having me.
Well, thank you for taking your time to join us today. I'm really excited. I know you and I have crossed paths many times in our careers. So this is actually a coming of sorts of our world. So super excited to have you. But Hamza, why don't you introduce yourself to our listeners, especially for those who may not know you. Tell us a little bit about yourself, who you are, and more importantly, what do you like to do when you're not growing or leading businesses?
Yeah, for sure, man. This is super exciting. It's like we get to catch up. What can I say? I'm a marketing professional. I've got a decade of experience in and around the education industry. I'm obsessed with closing the skills gap and lowering youth unemployment. Those are the two problems that I'm fixated on right now. How am I currently applying myself in solving those problems? One, I'm the managing director of Student Life Network. I'm a keynote speaker. I'm the author of The Burnout Gamble and a contributor to various publications. I'm a faculty member of Ryerson University and Seneca College, and I'm the co-founder of Skills Camp, a school for soft skills. What do I do when I'm not leading businesses? Good question.
Yeah. I mean, you just said so many things, so hopefully you have time for that, right?
Well, I think about this a lot, and I have to count my blessings. I feel privileged that so much of what I would do when not leading businesses is what I currently do to make a living. I'm learning, I'm writing, I'm teaching, I'm speaking, I'm consulting. But if you're asking what I'm doing for fun, I would say I'm a voracious consumer of movies. Growing up, movies were magic to me, and they haven't stopped being magic to me. The last movie I watched was a fantastic horror movie that I would highly recommend that you and all of the listeners watch. Mm-hmm. is called Hereditary. Such a good movie. Oh my God. Jumped right up there, right beside The Shining, in my top three horror movies favorites of all time. And I also love to travel. I'm very blessed and fortunate to be able to travel the world. I've been all over Europe this year. And actually, this week, I'm headed to Amsterdam.
Wow.
So yeah, that's about it.
That's fun. And I'm not jealous at all that you're traveling in the next week, because I am not traveling, but that's all good.
It's a tough life, man. What can I say?
I like it. Hamza, I mean, you mentioned so many things that you're involved with and things that you're really passionate about in the gap. But why don't we just jump right in and tell us a bit about Student Life Network. Let us know. I know you're the managing director. So what does that mean? What are your roles? And maybe what are you trying to accomplish over the next 6 to 12 months?
Yeah, I'd love to. At Student Life Network, we're trying to help over 1 million students across the country here in Canada to make the successful transition from high school through post-secondary and all the way to their careers and ultimately to their dream jobs. This is a problem rooted in my own lived experience and shared with millions of students across the country. These students feeling like they're not prepared, that they're saddled with debt, that they have the inability to boost their grades to be sufficient for whatever they're applying to next, that they don't have the right skills to be competitive in the modern economy, and most importantly, that they're graduating feeling unprepared for a job and ready for the world of work. So how are we solving that? We're collaborating with high-profile brands such as CIBC, Amazon, Ford, and Spotify to create helpful content, exclusive giveaways, and one-of-a-kind opportunities for our students. And like you mentioned, my current role is that of managing director. And the last part of your question is what do the next 12 months look like?
Yeah, like you guys are already doing many things, so I'm sure you have a vision.
Yeah, I'm just coming up just shy of a year here at Student Life Network, and we've already done quite a bit, but there's so much more left to do. Right now, we're working to harmonize our content strategy and our operations with the core business, which is currently giveaways. To that end, we're building a really comprehensive student journey map, scaling our marketing programs, which include influencer marketing and content creation, and becoming more and more data-driven overall to help address those real student problems that I just described. Every day we're doing things that help students reduce debt, boost grades, develop skills, and land jobs.
Well, that's amazing. I mean, I wish there was a student network there for me when I was in university as well. So like if you could, you know, wave a magic wand on the network right now, I mean, someone who is new to the network, what would that mean to them? Or what would that journey look like for them?
Yeah, what would that journey look like for them? That's a great question. I imagine that the perfect version of Student Life Network is one that anticipates the questions that any typical student has. I shouldn't say typical student because every student is different, but anticipates the questions that a student has based on a number of factors, their studying style, their experience, their age, you know, all thinking about all kinds of intersectionalities and identity types, what their career aspirations are, what their background is, and giving them curated resources, giving them the right message at the right time, whether that's a video, a podcast, an article, a giveaway, helping students at these moments of change to make better decisions, to make it more likely that they'll graduate into their dream jobs and get closer to their personal definitions of success. That's the dream vision, if I could wave a magic wand over Student Life Network.
Well, wow, that's great, and good luck, and let us know, and especially me, this is something that I'm always passionate about, and I'm always thinking about the future and how things are changing, especially with AI and machine learning. But I want to look back, and when I was perusing your LinkedIn, Hamza, and your career, mm-hmm. I mean, you're working with Student Life Network and helping these students go along this journey, but when I looked at your journey, you didn't look like you took that prototypical per se, quote unquote, trajectory of a marketing professional.
Oh, far
like
from, dude.
I mean, you've worked for amazing global brands, and you also teach, right? You teach at a university level.
Yeah.
So it's really interesting. So I'd love for you to share, I mean, from both sides of the world, or even specific, what were the key decisions that you had to make during your career that eventually allowed you to grow as the business leader you are today?
That's a great question, Edwin, and thank you for making that observation. And I hope that any of the listeners who are feeling confused about their career path based on what they've studied, listen very closely to what I'm about to say here. Let me try and think about how I want to say this. Growing up, I didn't have the same outlook on marketing as a career that I imagine people with more traditional or, as you said, prototypical intersectionalities might have. Think about it. I was the son of immigrant parents growing up in low socioeconomic circumstances and identified as a person of color. And back then, truthfully, I didn't think marketing was for me. When I looked at the world of marketing, I didn't see myself reflected. There was nobody who I saw that looked like me with my shared experiences who was at the top, let alone even at the front lines. So for a while, honestly, Edwin, I just kind of floundered. I tried to do the things that my parents wanted me to do. You know, you think mm-hmm. about the typical immigrant dream that parents want of their first generation kids. It's doctor, lawyer, engineer, for lack of a better trinity over there.
I'm one of the three, actually, that you mentioned.
There you go, then. And yeah, I tried very poorly to become all three. And I realized very quickly that at best, I was going to become a mediocre lawyer. And I went down that path for a couple of years, hence why I'm so obsessed with closing the youth unemployment gap and closing the skills gap, because that's a problem that I experienced firsthand. But more on that later. What started happening then for me, Edwin, is over the years, I started to see projections of success, starting with people like Rohit Bhargava, who was at Ogilvy at the time, then Shiv Singh, who was at Pepsi or MasterCard at the time, Indra Nooyi, Pepsi, Satish Kanwar, Toronto's very own at Shopify, Dev Basu, powered by Search. Now we see Sundar Pichai at Adobe, Satya Nadella at Microsoft, and the list goes on.
Right.
So what's been amazing for me to see with those intersectionalities that I described is a runway being extended. The runway of what's possible for me as a marketing professional, as an entrepreneur, as a business person is constantly being extended. But my guiding principles throughout that messy portion of my journey was simply trial and error, but with a growth mindset, which meant that every subsequent job that I took had less of what I didn't like in the last job and more of what I liked. It was a very iterative approach.
Of course.
And somewhere along that journey, I discovered the Ikigai framework, which for the listeners who aren't familiar with this, it elegantly describes the ingredients of purpose, which is four things, really. Number one, what you love. Number two, what the world needs. Number three, what you can be paid for. And number four, what you're good at. And somewhere in the quadrangulation of all four of those things is the thing you're meant to do for the rest of your life. And practicing regular reflection and being open to constructive criticism and mentorship has helped me to move closer and closer to my purpose.
Appreciate that. So when you, you're talking about that, it's really all that reflection and the mentorship. And you've changed roles as well. When I did look back in organizations, and as you did, Hamza, obviously your team and responsibly changed along with them. So I'm really interested, and this is always fascinating to me, how business leaders are able to adjust and continually grow, like right, as an effective leader throughout your career, because things are changing all the time. And sometimes you move to a role that you felt like maybe it might be a wrong one, or the team didn't or whatnot. Yeah.
That's interesting. And how I adjusted and continually grew as a leader throughout my career. I think I credit, first of all, good parenting with my being open to receiving what I call the ARC values, ARC, attunement, resilience, and creativity. I think that those three values in conjunction have allowed me to adapt to and outlast all kinds of change, be it personal, professional, even academic, I'd say. Mm-hmm. And you asked about teams, right? Right, Edwin?
Yeah, 100%.
So I think when it comes to my teams, attunement enabled me to, I'd say, empathize with them and understand their motivators and obstacles. Resilience enabled me to withstand difficult situations and conversations. And creativity enabled me to see the connections between seemingly disparate points. And as I mentioned, those three values, they form the acronym ARC. And I think that's so fitting because it allows you to get through difficult situations, cross bridges. It has allowed me to withstand and adapt to change throughout my career. And I have every confidence that those three values, specifically those three values, will continue to allow me to do that for the rest of my career.
That's great. Can you think of a specific situation where you actually had to go through each of those values to either help you, you know, overcome either it was a decision or something that was coming up? It could have been an irate employee or a customer, like where you really had to systematically like go through it and understand like, okay, this is what it means now to go through these values.
Yeah. Let me see if I can fish for an example that's recent. Okay. Yeah, I have one. This is when I was running my own digital marketing agency called Splash Effect. We had a client that was in the wellness space. Lovely client, but the person at the head of this organization had a very specific leadership and management style, which for lack of a better phrase, I would describe as like a bull in a china shop.
Yeah.
Very, very headstrong, very bold, often to the point of being brash. And you think about the team that we had cultivated, very quiet, introspective, gentle. It was difficult for this team to work with this particular person in the organization. And there was one one moment where we were not only behind on a deadline, but actually something that we were building for this client, a website, a web portal, was crashing. It wasn't a good scene. We weren't proud. We weren't happy. We were terrified of how this was going to play out with this particular client. So we tried everything in our power to get the website up and running in time for this client, but forces beyond our control prevented us from doing that. We didn't manage the project correctly, and ultimately we had to go and face this client and say, "Hey, like, not only is it not done, it's actually broken."
Oh my.
And those were probably one of the worst 48 hours in the business history. I mean, we were at the receiving end of a lot. This client was irate. This client led us to believe that we were going to lose the contract, that we were less qualified than we were. And I had to sit with that. My business partner and I had to sit with that and ask ourselves in that moment, what do we do? How do we rescue this project? How do we listen to the client and hear them, actually hear them, and try to get to the underlying factors that are making them feel this way? So it required us to put aside our feelings, to put aside history, and just be active listeners and practice that. And that's the attunement piece. But at the same time, also listening to our team and understanding their concerns and how they're feeling and making sure that all of the stakeholders feel heard. Then when it came to resilience, it was about reminding the team that we had actually been through much worse, mm-hmm. and that this one client wasn't the make or break for us, that even if we were to lose this contract, that we would still be okay. We would still make payroll. That this wasn't something that would color us for the rest of our careers. This wasn't something that would determine our future as marketing professionals. And once we were able to cross that hurdle of attunement and resilience, we had the clarity to focus on being creative and finding a solution that would respect the actual deadlines and at the same time help the client reach their goals. And so what we did is we rolled up our sleeves, and over a weekend hackathon, we built something that held over the client's business objectives until we could find a solution to fixing the problems that we were dealing with. And so I think that's a very short, albeit long-winded explanation of a way with one particular client in one instance that we utilized all three of those values to navigate a challenge that I think would have broken a less experienced agency and really demotivated people who didn't have the same focus on the ARC values.
No, that's a great example, and I could relate providing telecommunication services in the business and, you know, telecom being, you know, mission critical sometimes for depending on the type of organization. And we've had some days when something went wrong, and man, it's really belittling sometimes being on that end of the telephone call.
You never want to hear it. You never want to see those emails that make you cringe. You never want to see that name on your phone when they're calling you at an odd hour of the night, because that usually means that something's wrong, and you're going to experience a level of stress that could completely derail you. And so one of the themes of my life has been about developing better resistance to stress, developing my resilience, nurturing resilience such that I can control my response to it.
Hey there, how are you enjoying this conversation that I had with Hamza Khan? Hamza's such a down-to-earth guy and has plenty of insights when it comes to marketing, business leadership. This episode is brought to you by Dell Small Business, and there's nothing small about your small business. Learn how digital transformation can unlock the potential of your business and pave the way to innovation. If you are enjoying this podcast, please sign up to our monthly newsletter where we share our latest interviews, events, and upcoming guests. Go to thebusinessleadership.com/newsletter. Now let's get back to it.
This might be a great segue to this, Hamza. I mean, and I want to bring it up. I mean, you mentioned that you wrote a book. And the book for the listeners out there is called The Burnout Gamble.
Yes.
And perhaps this is right timing for me to bring this up. So can you tell us about it and really why you're passionate about it?
For sure. Thank you for giving me the platform to speak about it. The Burnout Gamble is a book that I began to write in the aftermath of my final brush with occupational burnout a few years ago. This, Edwin, was a particularly bad episode that saw me collapse mentally, physically, emotionally, and even spiritually, now that I think about it. In the process of learning about what had happened to me and how to recover, I began to realize that this was a macro problem that was hiding in plain sight. It was scary. Mm-hmm. So big that the World Health Organization has called stress the health epidemic of the 21st century.
Wow.
And so my book is for fellow overachievers, people like yourself and myself, who are on the brink of burnout, going through burnout, or recovering from it. The book is part antidote, part immunization, told from the perspective of someone who has been there, done that, and frankly, never wants to do it again.
Mm-hmm. So for the listeners, and maybe for myself in terms of the cool notes, how does one, you know, see the signs of occupational burnout? And what are maybe two or three things that me as a high achiever could do to really not go down that road?
Yeah, that's a great question. At the core of my book is the research of two doctors, Dr. Herbert Freudenberger and Dr. Gail North, the people who coined the term burnout. And they actually listed out the 12 stages of burnout. Mm-hmm. If you don't mind, could I just read them off here?
100%.
Yeah, let me just flip to that page in my book over here. I should have it memorized by now, right? here no we go. Problem. So stage one is the compulsion to prove oneself. Stage two is working harder. Stage three is neglecting needs. Stage four is displacement of conflicts. Stage five is revision of values. Stage six is denial of emerging problems. Stage seven is withdrawal. Stage eight is odd behavioral changes. Stage nine is depersonalization. Stage 10 is inner emptiness. Stage 11 is depression. And stage 12 is full-blown burnout syndrome.
Wow.
And how can you overcome burnout? Well, it really depends on if you are trying to prevent burnout or recover from it. But I would say the first three steps that you should take, no matter where you're at, is to deload your priorities, which means that when you're burning out, you are overwhelmed. There's too much going on. There's too many things jam-packed in your calendar, too many things that are demanding your attention. So get back to what's essential and start pushing away guilt-free the things that are not essential.
And the number key word two, there is probably guilt-free, right?
Oh, yeah. You have to. I mean, this means backing out of lunch meetings, coffee dates, birthdays, reclaiming your weekends. Wherever you can get time, take it because you need
right.
it. Number two, I'd say the thing you can do is to reconfigure your focus. One of the things that happens when you're burning out is that you lose sense of direction. You lose your connection, from your why, from your reason for being. Mm-hmm. So take the time to reflect and engage in the corrective exercises such as journaling, meditation, just reflection, you know, strength finder exercises and the lot to reconnect with the reason why you're doing what you're doing so that you can get back on track. And then the third thing I would say to do is to assemble boundaries, again, around your time, your energy, and your attention, because, right now all three are being, they're being besieged by those factors that I mentioned in part one, the notifications, work, family, friends, concerns. You want to prevent yourself from relapsing back to ways of being, thinking, and doing that made you burn out in the first place. So once you've been able to deload your priorities and reconfigure your focus, you need to assemble boundaries around your three valuable resources, time, energy, attention, such that you don't relapse.
Well, that's amazing. Well, thank you for sharing that. And if you haven't read the book, we'll definitely, it's called The Burnout Gamble. Could, I'm sure, be available anywhere in your bookstore. And I might be just giving away one at the end of this episode.
Yes. Actually, let's talk about that afterwards. I'd love to hook you up with a couple of books that you can make available to listeners of the podcast.
Okay. Yeah, for sure. Hamza, I just wanted to change of direction, and this question is more personal and within my interest, and I really want to ask you, given the fact that you are in front of the next generation and you're talking to these people and you're really understanding what they're going through, but with the growth of AI in the workplace, so I'm really curious of what type of skills you think are needed now not only for the incoming workforce, but also the people that have been in, been working for 5, 10, 15 years?
Man, you literally asked a billion-dollar question over here. When you think about by the year 2020, I think McKinsey put out a study earlier this year talking about how nearly 70% of jobs, I think, don't quote me on that, are going to be affected and mm-hmm. or outright, in some cases, just replaced by AI. Mm-hmm. You're asking the right question. And my advice would be this, and I can't stress this enough. The only way that we can outlast this machine learning revolution is through soft skills. The skills that you didn't think were important when you were in school, the human skills. Anything else can, and I promise you, will be automated. At the very least, simplified so as to not enable a full and or meaningful living. So double down, triple down, quadruple down on developing your soft skills. Now, Edwin, fortunately, we've rehearsed and continue to rehearse these man versus machine scenarios all the time, especially in movies. You know, you think about every single time what's being dramatized in these movies. What are the things that allow us to escape the Matrix, to defeat the Terminators, to unplug HAL 9000? Mm-hmm. I would say they're a combination of skills. They're attunement, resilience, creativity, empathy. What else? Compassion, communication, boldness, confidence, listening, leadership, emotional intelligence. I could go on and on and on. I believe this so much that in fact, I created a company dedicated to helping teams cultivate their soft skills called Skills Camp, which is a soft skills training company. So the short answer here is soft skills. Invest in them heavily, please.
And when you talk about soft skills, I know it's a word. It's really an umbrella term. So for someone, and I'm just going to do it for example's purposes, is someone who's a developer, heavy developer, what would the soft skill he needs to excel in the new world?
That's a great question. So let me just pick three that come to mind. I would say the first one is the intergenerational workforce and understanding that this developer is likely working in a place and or with other companies in which there are four generations under the roof right now. You've got Generation Z, Generation Y, Generation X, and the boomers. And so understanding how to work with them, you know, what their lived experiences are, what their contexts are, will allow them to be effective, to anticipate problems, and to troubleshoot and get the most out of teamwork and collaboration situations. Another one that comes to mind is burnout management. I would say stress management, rather. That's a huge problem. As I mentioned, when I was talking about the burnout gamble, it's going to affect almost everyone at some level. So understanding things like self-care, developing good and sustainable wellness practices will help them stay in the fight for much longer and avoid burning out. And then another one is just communication, communications and presentation. So this developer is going to have to talk about their work. This developer is going to have to advocate for their ideas. Mm-hmm. This developer is going to have to go and pitch their company if they're at the front of it or working in some sort of leadership capacity. So those are examples of soft skills that are essential to their work. Because you know this as an engineer is that it's becoming easier and easier to do the work of the engineer. And I remember this as somebody who dabbled in it a couple of years ago, is that now when I look back, I can see that a lot of the things that I took for granted that I had to hard code are now available through a simplified user interface, or those functions are now just being done outright by the system. And eventually we'll get to a place where, you know, you're just kind of speaking into your devices and it's doing everything for you. So how do we anticipate that world? How do we prepare for that world? I forget who said it, and I should really remember this, but I think I'm going to paraphrase it here. The illiterate of the next generation are going to be those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn.
Wow.
And, all three of those things are at the heart of the growth mindset of lifelong learning as a philosophy, and, lend themselves so well to soft skills. They're a very complementary, philosophy to have.
Hamza, can you name a person who has had a tremendous impact on you as a business leader?
Wow. Edwin, there's too many, and I think I'd be doing the rest of them a disservice by only picking one. But
sure.
For the sake of this, I would say the one who I've been thinking a lot about recently is somebody who you might know, actually, Drew Dudley, TEDx keynote speaker. He did the lollipop moment, and he's the author of a book coming out very soon called This Is Day One. Him and I met back when I was a student at the University of Toronto, and he was, I believe, the coordinator of its leadership development program. At a critical juncture in my life, at a moment of change, he taught me the value of holistic development, which is personal development, professional development, academic development, this idea of a whole student. And over the years, he taught me how to operationalize my leadership values, how to do things every single day that will make it more likely that I can confidently say I have those skills that I've described throughout this podcast. Mm-hmm. In his new book, I think he's sharing all of that wisdom, and I had the pleasure of reading a few early snippets of it. He goes into detail with those practical frameworks that I use till this day, and I hope one day he gets to be on this podcast, and I can't wait for all of the listeners to check out his book. This is day one.
Well, we definitely have to have him on here, definitely talking about that, because it sounds like something I need to read as well. Yeah, speaking about books, Hamza, I mean, every business leader, they have an interesting nightstand. So I'm really interested to know what you're currently reading right now.
Well, Edwin and listeners of the podcast, don't judge me. I'm reading a book called, I kid you not, it's called The World According to Kanye. Ah. And this is by my friend Herbert Louis. We're both creatives, both people who at a young age were inspired by Mr. West. Mm-hmm. For what it's worth, I think he inspired our entire generation, no matter what we think about him at this stage of his career, whether in music, culture, fashion. Herbert extracted nuggets of wisdom from various interviews of Kanye West and laid them out in a beautiful book that I think he designed himself. And these insights are helping me to better understand the mindset of someone who has and continues to, as I said earlier, extend the runway of what's possible for me.
That's a great recommendation. We'll list it on the podcast episode website. Yeah. And I'm really interested to learn more, and I'll definitely look it up.
The World According to Kanye.
Hamza, fun question. If I were to ask any of your teammates, past or present, colleagues, peers, what is the best leadership quality that Hamza possess? What do you think they'll say?
That's a good one. That's a good one. They have said, and I hope they still say, that I'm a good listener. I'm an active listener, and I'm genuinely curious and interested in them and their worlds. I think in an age where everyone is talking and broadcasting, I think the ability to hear, and I mean actually hear, is truly special. We as humans, we want to be heard. We want to feel acknowledged and understood. And honestly, it's just amazing what you learn when you actually pay attention.
That's great. And that's probably something listed under soft skills, right, Hamza?
Yeah, absolutely. Right up there at the top.
So what else? Do you have any other special projects? I know you have a number of things on the go, but perhaps initiatives, some new initiatives, or really something fun that you're like super excited about and you're losing sleep right now that you'd like to share.
Great question. Great question. I'm super excited about my trip to Amsterdam, which is coming up very soon. But as far as special projects, initiatives, or other things are concerned, we're coming up on the 1 year anniversary of the Burnout Gamble. I can't believe that we've been in market for 1 year. I'm so excited. The second edition of the book is now available online, Amazon, Indigo, Chapters, Barnes and Noble, you name it. And it's going to be carried in more stores. I think it's seeing the rounds currently at Indigo stores, but we're going to see it possibly in Walmart, Shoppers Drug Mart very soon as well. And new versions of the book are going to be available, particularly an audiobook and an online course. As I mentioned, I'd love to hook you up with a few copies to share with your listeners. So let's talk about that after, if you're still open to it.
Definitely. Awesome.
I'm also doing a lot more writing. You can get access to my weekly dispatches by signing up for my newsletter at hamzakhan.ca/newsletter. And I've got some pretty awesome speaking engagements coming up, a few of which I hope will be open to the public as well.
Great. That's amazing. You're always inspiring. So keep that up, Hamza.
Thank you.
Really, really happy to have you. But before we end, ideally, if you could share some final thoughts, observations, any actionable recommendations that you could share with someone who's listening, either they're an emerging business leader, perhaps there's someone who's going through school, and anyone who's listening today.
Yeah. So much I want to say, but you know, thinking through the lens of the burnout gamble, I would say nurture that resilience muscle and do things every day that scare you. Turn up the difficulty incrementally in areas of your life where you're comfortable, because comfort can lead to complacency, and complacency will catch you off guard when the going gets tough. So you're going to want to invest in your physical fitness, your health, your well-being, set ambitious goals for yourself, choose the path less taken, and face the things that will face you regardless if you choose to face them or not. There's something in your life right now. There's multiple things in your life that you know you're not confronting, but are still facing you regardless. It could be a bad relationship. It could be a failing business. It could be your own insecurities. It could be imposter syndrome. Whatever it is, choose to face them head on regardless of how you feel, because those things are going to face you whether you choose to face them or not. You have no idea of what you're truly capable of until you reach the edges of your comfort zone and then take gradual steps outside of them. So that's what I would say.
That's awesome. Thank you, Hamza. So to close, can you tell us where we can find more information about you, your company, your book, or anything else?
Yeah, let's start with the company. You can learn more about Student Life Network by going to studentlifenetwork.com or following us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. To learn more about me, check out hamzakhan.ca. Follow me on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn. Let me know what you thought about this episode. Drop me a line if you want any further clarification or have any follow-up questions. I'm more than happy to keep this conversation going. And be sure to subscribe to my newsletter at hamzakhan.ca/newsletter. That's about it, Edwin.
Awesome. Well, Hamza, it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you for joining us on the Business Leadership Podcast.
Wow, the pleasure was all mine. Thank you. Thank you so much for this opportunity to be on this incredible platform. And thank you to all the listeners for tuning in week over week. It's an absolute honor.
That's it, biz leaders. Thank you for joining me on the Business Leadership Podcast, episode number 68 with Hamza Khan. If you want to learn more about Hamza, the Student Life Network, or his book, The Burnout Gamble, or really anything else that we discuss, please go to thebusinessleadership.com/068. This episode is brought to you by Dell, empowering Canadian entrepreneurs with the tools, technology, and resources they need to succeed. Also, the Business Leadership Podcast is a friend of the ITWC Podcast Network and supported by our media partner, IT World Canada. If you have not done so yet, please subscribe to the podcast on iHeartRadio, Spotify, iTunes, or wherever you listen to your podcast. Thank you again. Edwin signing off.
Thank you for listening to the Business Leadership Podcast at thebusinessleadership.com.